आवाज आ रही मेरी? कैन यू हियर मी प्लीज? ओके ओके बेटे, एक्चुअली आज वैसे तो हमारी फर्स्ट क्लास है, लेकिन 10:30 पे वो मेरे बीएससी के जो स्टूडेंट्स हैं उनका वाइवा भी है, तो 10:30 से 11:30 तक बीच में फिर मैं ब्रेक भी लूँगी, एंड देन आपके 11:30 अगेन यू आर सपोज टू ज्वाइन इन. सो लेट्स स्टार्ट विद टुडेज टॉपिक विच इज कंफ्लिक्ट मैनेजमेंट एंड डिस्प्यूट रेजोल्यूशन इन कंस्ट्रक्शन इंडस्ट्री. आई विल क्विकली गो थ्रू दिस टॉपिक. बेसिकली यू मस्ट हैव यूज दिस वर्ड कंफ्लिक्ट एंड डिस्प्यूट इंटरचेंजेबली. मीन्स वी डू नॉट डिफ्रेंशिएट बिटवीन दीज टू वर्ड्स और टर्मिनोलॉजीज एज सच, बट इन केस ऑफ कंस्ट्रक्शन इंडस्ट्री देर इज a huge difference between these two terminologies. So conflict is basically a disagreement on any issue. So a disagreement in case of construction industry could be because of their different perception of the stakeholders involved. These perceptions could be in terms of, if you just keep following my cursor, in terms of interest, values, needs, action, direction, or basically their interest. So there is incompatibility or disagreement between the stakeholders in the construction industry. So here, if you just follow my cursor, we do say in construction industry that conflict is what that happens before dispute occurs. So how does it work? Basically, just like any other, just like your everyday life, you may have certain disagreements arising due to some issue. Disagreements are natural wherever human beings are involved on certain things. So on this disagreement, if you just follow this diagram, problem arises, then there is disagreement, then one party claims that I have got certain grievances, or I'm an aggrieved party, and there is something that went wrong against me. So here, up to this claim and up to this zone, this calls dispute avoidance, that you keep avoiding the dispute, and in case you could resolve your issue, your problem, your disagreement up to here, you just claim, made a claim, but this claim is being resolved, this claim is being managed between the two parties. For example, on a construction project, the conflict may arise between the client and contractor. So up to here, up to this unshaded zone, if this conflict is managed between these two parties, this is up to here, it is called conflict management or dispute avoidance zone. But as soon as this claim is made and the parties find that they cannot resolve it, they cannot solve this conflict between themselves, between these two parties, and then they look for some third party, then this same problem, same disagreement will be considered as dispute, and one of the party may reach to the third party for some legal action maybe. So this is this diagram basically shows the escalation process of dispute. So in this dispute avoidance zone, basically if two parties do not need any third party and manage their issue between themselves, this is up to here we call dispute avoidance, and this is basically the zone of conflict management as well. But if you couldn't manage your conflict, you enter into this dispute zone, and then you require dispute resolution system or setup, which could be some civil courts or some other setup, which I'll be talking in this lecture. Potential causes of conflict and in a way causes of dispute, they are bit similar to each other. So let's go through them one by one. So potential causes for conflict may be this schedule disagreement that client may be thinking to schedule the project in some other way than the contractor. Because some units construction may be more important to the client as compared to the contractor. But contractor will schedule any project according to the availability of his own resources. So there a disagreement could arise. It's very natural that these disagreements may come up. But as long as both of these parties do resolve that between themselves, that will be called conflict management. Priorities may be differ for client and contractor. As I said, that priorities to construct certain parts of the construction may be more important to the client as compared to the contractor. But contractor may look for a wholesome delivery of the project. So these prioritization may be different and may become the cause of conflict. Human resources management, like for instance, client may be wanting certain staff or certain employees to work on his project, but they might not be available with the contractor. Means they might be busy on some other project of the contractor. So this may cause some conflict. Then technical issues may be there. For example, the client may be wanting certain construction of certain units in certain technical ways, but contractor might not be using those ways. This may cause a conflict. Then administrative procedures are basically cause of miscommunication or late communication. So they again become the cause of conflict, just like our public sector. The decision making or authority is very much confined over the top ranks. So there are these administrative procedures of getting approvals or giving a go-ahead to contractor. They are very difficult and they are basically delayed. So this may become a cause of conflict. Then personality clash may be there, just like your everyday life. Certain people might not be feeling comfortable working with other people. This may become the cause of conflict. Then cost, of course, always becomes a cause of conflict. Client wants to end the project with the least expense, whereas for contractor, similarly, contractor also wants the project to end in with the least cost. But in case some variations are considered, then the cost for those variations are included. So in a way, if contractor is claiming a higher cost, that won't be very happily considered by the client and may become a cause of conflict. So again, conflict management approach says that both of the parties do not require any third party to manage this matter between themselves. So until and unless both of the parties, like client and contractor, do conflict between themselves, this is called conflict. They look for a third party intervention. This dispute becomes a conflict becomes a dispute. So basically, for conflict management, there are certain ways of or certain approaches to manage this conflict, and project managers are supposed or are considered to be the ones who are basically having these sort of traits in their personality or in their techniques to manage the project. So these techniques basically involves a person's attempts to satisfy his or her own concerns or attempts to satisfy the other's concerns. Like for instance, project manager is considered to be the one who is basically well versed with the ways in which whether he will be looking for the conflict management ways in which he could satisfy his own party's concerns or otherwise. If he sees that the problem is genuine, genuinely arised by the other party, then he is considering to satisfy the other party's concerns. So this is a trade between satisfying your concern or the other party's concern. So with this philosophy, we have got these five techniques of conflict management. So first technique is integration or collaborative approach. So in case of huge long-term projects, especially in the beginning of the project, this technique is used where projects are complex and you are looking for a long-term relationship on that project. Then both parties do have a high concern for oneself and the other party. So there they use this technique of integration or collaboration. They look for such strategies in which are satisfactorily considered by both the parties. Because both the parties take care of each other's concerns with high importance. So this technique is called integration technique. Other one is called obliging or accommodating technique. Here, one party gives up or leaves or concede, this word concede is used here, may concede from an issue if that appears to be more important to the other party. So this type of technique project managers do use when they find that other party's concerns are more important than ours. So for a better or good relationship, it's okay to concede your concerns and for the other party. Then next technique is called dominating or competing. Here in this technique, basically you do consider your concerns with more or deeper sense as compared to the other party's concerns. So you give low importance to the other party's concerns as compared to your party's concern. So this approach is not very good for a long-term relationship. This is only good for quick decision-making or short-term resolution of the problems. Comes the withdrawal or avoiding technique, in which you give a low concern to yourself and to other parties' concerns as well. So both parties' concerns are not given that much importance in this technique. But this again depends upon the type of the problem. And it's again a short-term strategy for handling conflict, not for a long-term relationship. Then comes the compromising or negotiation technique. This is the most considered technique or most appreciated technique in which there is a balanced view of both parties concerned. So you give equal importance to not only to your own concerns and issues, but to the other party's concerns. And in case of construction projects, this is one of the highly appreciated technique, that you do sit on a table, you do talk to each other, and you do bargain with each other, basically. So in this technique, you concede certain things in return of certain other things which are given by the other party. So Okay, so up to here, this conflict topic ends, then rest is about the dispute. I'll talk about that topic later at 11:30. So give me a break for 1 hour. I join you again at 11:30. I take your attendance now, and I'll be taking your attendance at 11:30 as well. Let me take your attendance. I share this attendance with you here. So I'm sorry about this inconvenience, but this is only for this week. And today's the Wawas will end, and definitely we won't have this trouble again. So I end this lecture here, but join me in again at 11:30 p.m. सेटिंग तो ये है ठीक है आई होप कि अपनी हो राइट सो वी वर टॉकिंग अबाउट फर्स्ट वी वर टॉकिंग अबाउट कॉजेज ऑफ कॉन्फ्लिक्ट नाउ लेट्स टॉक अबाउट सम कॉजेज ऑफ डिस्प्यूट्स सिमिलर टू द कॉन्फ्लिक्ट्स बट नाउ दीज कॉजेज आर मोर When we do write a contact document, then we do write such sort of causes in terms of certain situations in those contact documents as well. So here, first cause of dispute is call acceleration. This means that many times to meet the deadline, the client pushes the contactor to complete the work in more accelerated way. And then client simply says that you just completed the amount of work which you were initially asked for. You didn't do anything extra, but they just forget about the cost of acceleration. That means in case the contractor has to deliver the project quickly or in a lesser time as compared to the initially set time, then that of course they'll have to employ more number of people and more number of equipment to complete that work. So therefore, there is an additional cost of acceleration. But in case client withdraws and simply says that you just did the amount of work you were asked for, then that becomes a likely cause of dispute. Then coordination issue are always there, mostly in case of public projects. We are for example, in public sector like us, the authority is very much confined with the top ranks. So therefore, it takes more time to make approvals, to make decisions, and hence this coordination may cause the dispute of or the delays in making decisions. Then, of course, in Pakistan, you do not see a diverse range of people, but still, you may find people from other provinces. So similarly, on some international projects, there it is possible that people from different countries, from different backgrounds, religious and regional backgrounds, do come. And there, that difference of culture may cause a certain dispute at the construction place. So maybe, for example, being Muslim, you have to take a break for your prayers. And that might not be considered very good by the other people on that place. So such sort of things may cause dispute. Then differing goals means client and contractors do have always a different goal, though they have one set aim of completing the project on time. But of course, you may say that the benefit of one party may become the disadvantage to the other party. For instance, if the project is more profitable for the contractor, that simply means it will be an expensive option for the client. And otherwise, if it's a good option for client, may not be that profitable for the contractor. So these are the different goals. If they both of these parties do pursue, that means you may end up in certain disputes. Then delays in the project. So fixing the responsibility of delays basically is one of the main cause of dispute on construction projects, that who or which party was actually responsible for the delay in construction completion. Then design errors could be there. Design might not be communicated well through all the parties, so you may end up in additional cost for those errors, and again it becomes a cause of dispute. Then engineer and engineer's representatives may become cause of conflict, because these are the people who are in a way more inclined towards their own employers as compared to the project itself. Because, I mean, for instance, they become more a caretaker for their employer just to remain in good books of them. But on the other hand, they may be they may become more biased on for that particular project. So thereby, they are causing likely disputes on the project for undue favor of their employers' goals or interest. Then complex projects are inherently more likely to different sort of disputes. For example, in complex projects, risk assessment and distribution that involves complexity. So therefore, some party may not find it very good for them. So that's again a likely cause of dispute. Then quality and workmanship of the people and the construction. So now client may not be that happy with the quality of the construction work, and maybe with the performance of the people working on that project. That may become a cause of dispute. Then site conditions. For instance, it's not suitable or appropriate for any contractor to explore to conduct site investigations, because all sort of site investigations before taking up a project, it's not that sort of cost effective. So in case some hard site conditions come up and client does not watch for its responsibility of taking care of those harsh conditions, and of course that is a likely cause of dispute for the contractor. Then any sort of tender mistakes or in the process of tendering may result in disputes between these parties, because this will end up in an additional cost, and whenever there is an additional cost, that is a likely source or cause of dispute. Then comes the variations. Some of the variations are always included in the tender amount, but to identify that the variations made on construction site fall within that within that mentioned limit of variations which are included in the contract, that is a likely cause of dispute. Means all the time client tries to consider or quantify all the said variations within that given limit of variations or included limit of variations in the client in the contract. But on the contrary, the contractor may work less or work on lesser quantity of variations, but I would like to claim them, claim their cost, and I would like to quantify them out of that included range or limit. So that is one of the likely cause of dispute. So to handle the disputes, contrary to conflict management, where you do not need any third party, but here you do involve a third party, especially on a large size project. This third party is constituted by the stakeholders themselves. This is called dispute resolution board. Basically, this dispute resolution board is developed or made by the client and with the mutual consent of client and contractor, and they have to pay them. So in a way, this is an additional cost to the project as well. And how this DRB is constituted, basically the client and contractor do choose two technical people. So one technical person is chosen by the client, another technical person will be chosen by the contractor. And these technical people do have the work experience of more than 25 or 30 years. So these are kind of senior people, technical people who have got extensive construction experience. Then these two people do select or do choose an other legal person from a legal background, maybe some lawyer, maybe some construction law expert person. So these three people then become the part of a dispute resolution board. And then whenever any problem arises, any disagreement arises on the construction site, this DRB is approached and they give some verdict to that dispute or agreement, disagreement. And then that becomes a binding, a contract binding to obey the decision of this DRB by both the parties. But in case if some party is still not happy with the decision made by this DRB, they have got another venue available, which is your civil court. So finally, they may go for a legal action. So in case you want to go for a legal action, it is mandatory for you to get the verdict or decision of the DRB as well. So before going for a legal action, you must have DRB decision with you, and then you may go for the legal action or legal route through the simple civil courts. So this is how these DRBs work. And in case of courts, the decisions of DRB are merely considered as breach of the contract. So do understand this thing, that if you do not follow the decision of the DRB, that won't have certain legal implications apart from being a breach of the contract. And of course, for a breach of the contract, you do have legal implications defined by that legal jurisdiction. So this was it for about these conflict and disputes. And then our next topic. ये क्या है जी बेटे, अटेंडेंस जो है ये एक पार्ट की तो मैंने पहले ले ली है, दूसरे की अभी लेक्चर के बाद मैं लूंगी। और अटेंडेंस मैंने पहले वाली भी आप लोगों से शेयर कर दी थी। अच्छा जी, सो नेक्स्ट टॉपिक इज अबाउट प्रोजेक्ट मैनेजमेंट। सो व्हाट डू वी कॉल ए प्रोजेक्ट? These few words are highlighted here if you follow my cursor. So project is always a temporary endeavor, means it has got certain start time and end time. Therefore, it is a temporary endeavor, but it consists of a sequence of connected activities. So it has got a number of connected activities, but along with the limited resource available, it has got specified time and budget as well, and you have to complete it within the given or as per the given specifications. So this is what we call a project. So project has got these particular traits. It has got, it is a temporary endeavor. Temporary means it has got certain start time and end date always, and then it has got limited resource available. So limited resource is in terms of the specified or limited time available to finish that project, and then a limit of budget or finances for that project, and then you have to complete this project as per the one specifications. So and then you may say that project in itself is a task or activity, but it is made up of smaller tasks or activities, which are mentioned here, that sequence of connected activities. So basically, if you complete these connected activities, you will reach to that target or the goal. and then undertaken by the limited resources in terms of manpower, in terms of material, in terms of money. So they are available in a certain limit. Then your project always a unique product or service means uniqueness is in terms of its timeline, in terms of the people working on that project. And there are so many other things which maybe quality standards are different, maybe the technical procedures are different on different projects. So that's why they become the unique product or service. And with this uniqueness, what comes up means you cannot replicate the one project with another one. For example, if you have to build a road in Lahore, you cannot simply or straight away say that the similar or the same project can be delivered maybe in some northern area or maybe in another province, because of difference of people working on that project, because of difference in supplies for that project, because of difference in timeline. So there are so many things which may make it unique. So it's not like that you buy an iPhone from Pakistan at the same cost which you will be buying maybe in the different regions of this country. So cost for iPhone, wherever you buy within Pakistan, will always remain same. Even throughout the world will remain same. But for a road project, in even within a country, for example, you building it in Lahore will differ from a project in Multan or in Karachi or in Faisalabad. So that's the difference between the construction project being a unique product or service. So this slide again explains the same thing, that you have a specific time, you have a limited budget, and you have to perform the budget, perform the project according to the specification. All right, so these are few features of being mentioned here for a project. Very self-explanatory, I won't go in detail, it's merely a repetition. Okay. So here, this slide mentions different types of projects and what type of end product you get from them. Again, a very self-explanatory slide, so I won't go in much detail here. Now, there are two things which we confuse with each other, but they are substantially different to each other. One is called project and other one is an operational activity. So let's see that what is the difference between a project and an operation. So basically, project is a temporary, if you follow my cursor, project is a temporary and unique activity. On the other hand, operations are ongoing or a repetitive activity. So if I explain it, for example, with an example, like for instance, for me, being a teacher in this organization, UET, it's an operational activity to teach here. For example, I'm teaching some students now. I'll be teaching the students the next semester and the next semester. So each year, a new session is coming up and I'm performing the same sort of job. So for me, it's an operational activity. But for you, being a student, it's a project. For example, for you, it's a project to complete this semester. You have got certain activities which are connected together. For example, first you will have to attend the classes. You will have your learning or teaching or coaching classes in certain labs or vivas, and then certain examinations are set out for you, and you are supposed to pass it through, and only then you will be completing this semester. But for you, this one semester is basically considered as a project. Completion to this one semester is a project. But for me, it's an operational activity. Today, I'm teaching you. Next time, I'll be teaching another class. And next time, another class. So for me, it's an operational activity. So for me, it's a repetitive exercise. But for you, going through this civil engineering course, whole course is basically a project. So here, how do we define it? For example, in this picture, this top picture, this defines a project, a construction activity. But this bottom picture, this is some customer service, maybe some banking setup, or maybe some administrative setup in some organization. So it is an operational activity. In this picture, this left one, go to the moon, is a project. But eating out in a restaurant is basically a routine or repetitive activity, and this will be called an operational activity. Doing grocery is your repetitive or operational activity, but here, this picture, bottom one, is a project activity. You do not need many times in your life, whole lifetime, so it's a project if you do that. So this slide mainly compares this operational and project activity. Very self-explanatory, I won't go in much detail here. Please have a look on this slide. It's telling you about some simple projects which you perform in your everyday life. These are a few examples of some complex type of projects. Again, some construction related projects mentioned here. All right, so then comes a few terminologies here. So we talked about a project, and now we talk about project management. So project and project management are different to each other. So project management here means these few activities, if you just follow my cursor: planning, organizing, motivating, and controlling resources to achieve specific goals. So project management is basically a process which you do perform within an organization and during the delivery of a project as well. So these processes are basically called project management, which include planning, organizing, motivating, and controlling the resources to achieve some specific goal. So for project management, you require different things. For example, you require a set of skills. Means you require certain skills to perform this process of management. You need certain tools, like for instance, on construction projects, we do have various softwares available as our tools, and then a series of processes. There are various processes as part of management, project management. We will be performing them on a project. It's just, this slide just gives you an idea that few things you need actually for management process. Then this slide explains about different definitions of project management. Very self-explanatory. You can have a look at your place. I won't go in much detail here. Okay, so we'll talk about this this slide. So this slide basically explains you about five principal functions of management. Now here I want to emphasize that these functions of management are basically performed by management or a group of or people who are managing an organization. Basically, these functions are performed within an organization for managing that organization. These are not about the project delivery. These are about the management process of an organization. So in case you manage an organization, first process you or the first function basically you perform is called planning. So let's talk about these functions one by one. So within an organization, when you are managing that organization, first function which you perform is called planning. Planning includes these sort of questions: what is to be done, when it is to be done, how it is to be done, and who is to do it. So basically answering these questions. is what we call planning as a function of for management in an organization. So planning and scheduling do come together. Like you not only plan that what is going to be done, how or where it is going to be done, but in addition to that, when it is to be done. So basically scheduling is about start, giving the start and finish time of that task or activity. So in planning and scheduling, in planning, basically you answer these four questions: what, how, where, and whom. And scheduling is about when. This answering this question when is called scheduling. Then comes organizing. So organizing is the process of bringing together physical, financial, and human resources, developing a productive relationship among them for achievement of organizational goal. So within an organization, organizing means you bring together the physical and financial and human resources. Physical, financial, and human resource together for achievement of the organizational goal. This process is called organizing. So organizing involves different activities like identification of activities, classification or grouping of activities, assignment of duties to different people, delegation of authority and creation of responsibility. Delegation means distributing the authority and creation of responsibility, coordinating authority and responsibility relationships. So basically defining the role, the responsibility of different people working within an organization is called the organizing. Then comes the staffing. Staffing is basically identifying the right people for the right job and bringing new people in the organization, developing their career, development or professional development plans need to be there, how many professional benefits they will get, identifying that is also part of staffing. Then their promotions and transfers, then their performance appraisals, this all is included in staffing. Then comes the directing or coordinating with the people within an organization. So direction has these elements, like how do you communicate with your staff, how you supervise them, how you motivate them for working in your organization, and how you lead them by the example. So for that purpose, the managerial leadership styles are evolved or are available there. These styles depend upon two things, like the directive behavior of the management and the supportive behavior of the management. So for example, in this this matrix, if you look at this red zone, empowering style or empowering leadership style, this style is only possible when you turn over the responsibility for day-to-day decision making for the people who have high competence and high commitment. This means if your organization have got employees who are highly competent and highly committed to the organization, then your managerial style would be more empowering when you will identify their roles and responsibilities. But opposite to that is more kind of a coaching behavior. Coaching behavior is for the people who are some competent and have some commitment. Means they are not strongly committed or strongly competent or highly competent, but they have got certain, I mean, average level of competence and average level of commitment. In that sort of organization, when you have got this sort of people, then your style becomes more sort of coaching. Then you become more directive and supportive to your staff. Another style is more sort of supporting style, in which you praise, listen, and facilitate your employees who are highly competent but variable commitment. Means they are highly competent, but they do have strong commitment towards their job. So in that sort of organization where you have got this sort of people, your style need to be more supportive. You need to compassionate with them. You need to be more praising or listening them. But opposite to that is more kind of directive style of managing. In this directing style of managing, you have got the people who have got low competence, but they are highly committed to towards their job. They are highly committed to the organization, towards their organization, but they have got low competence. So there, your managerial style should be more sort of directing, in which you have got to be more controlling and supervising your staff as compared to this supportive behavior. So these are different styles of managing. Then last bit you do in as part of your the project management within your organization is controlling. Controlling is always coming from the idea that it implies measurement of accomplishment against the standards. This simply means control comes from the idea that you have got certain standards set out for your organization that people must be fulfilling or employees must be fulfilling these standards. And in case they do not fulfill those standards, they deviate from those standards, then you have to look for those deviations. And then you have to see that what sort of corrective actions or measures you need to take so that you could achieve the goals of your organization. So controlling coming from the same idea by which, for example, being a child, your parents must be controlling you. Control means they have got certain lifestyle or certain way of doing things in your mind. And if you, being a child, you deviate from those things, they try to take the corrective actions or corrective measures. So similarly, within an organization, you set out certain standards, parameters of doing things. And if your employees do not perform according to that, then you look for the corrective actions which you need to take. So here, this chart elaborates this idea more. You set the certain performance standards. You measure those performance standards of your employees. You compare those standards with this. You compare those measured performance with the standard performance, and then you find that whether there has been some deviation or not. If you have met the standards, then you reinforce and continue your work. But if you have not met the standards, then you need to take the corrective actions, and then again this cycle will go on. So this was about basically the five functions which you perform within an organization for management of that organization. Now we'll talk about five processes which you perform for the management of the project on a particular project. Now the same organization, if is going to deliver a project, then these are the five process groups which you do perform which you do perform as part of the project. आई होप अब आपको आ ही रही होगी. बेसिकली आप में से ही मुझे लग रहा है कि कोई म्यूट कर देता है स्पीकर को. हालांकि ये मैंने चॉइसेस तो वो सेटिंग तो की हुई है, लेकिन स्टिल आई डोंट नो. लेकिन इट्स ऑल अप टू यू. अगर आप लोग उस तरह सीरियस नहीं है, ये रिकॉर्ड भी हो रही है कन्वर्सेशन. आई विल सिंपली कन्वे दिस टू द हायर अप्स कि कितने आप लोग इंटरेस्टेड हैं इन क्लासेस में, ऑनलाइन क्लासेस में. Anyways, I'll continue from here. So initiating means you have to define a new project. So you conceive an idea of the project, And with that, these two things you perform. One is called project charter and the stakeholder register. So basically you identify different stakeholders, and then project charter basically includes defining the project that and defining the idea which you want to work on. Then planning stage includes this plan the work. So whatever the work you want to do, you basically plan at this stage. So this basically includes these sort of things like defining the scope in the documented form, then writing the requirements of the project, scheduling your project, identifying its cost, quality, human resource, communication mechanism between the stakeholders, risk on your project, what procurement means purchase will be done on the project, what changes could be there, for the stakeholders involved on the project. Then executing phase basically involves the work the plan phase, means whatever you have planned in this phase of planning, now you will be working that plan. So basically it involves the delivery of the deliverables, project deliverables. So in this stage, you basically work on the project deliverables. You also assess the work performance. You also assess the team performance. You look for the project communication mechanism. You make change requests available, in what way they are delivered, in what way they are executed. Issue log is developed in this execution phase, and then comes the monitoring and controlling phase. So here again, whatever the standard you have set out for your project, you look for the deviations here. So basically you are looking for the change logs. Basically change logs are change registers. Whatever the change request is sent to the contractor will make a register or log of that request, then approve change. So out of these requested changes, what are the changes which are actually approved to work on? Then work performance information is monitored. Schedule forecast is monitored. Cost is monitored. Forecast of cost is monitored. So here, all these things you basically look from the documents which you planned at the planning phase, and then you see that whether you are as per your plan or not. And then comes the closing phase in which you end the work. So here you get the approval of your end product and you stop or close any further procurements for the project. This slide again explains the same thing. This chart basically tells you that initiating phase comes in the beginning of the project, then comes the planning phase, which is you plan more thing in the beginning as compared towards the end time of the project. Then monitoring and control goes throughout the planning till the closing of the project, and then at the end you see the closing of your project. So those were the five process groups, and now out of those process groups, if you just eliminate the project controlling or monitoring phase, the rest of the phases basically define the project life cycle. So project life cycle mainly composes of these four phases: project initiation, planning, execution, and closure. So if you just see, only one thing is missing here, which is called project monitoring and controlling. So that is basically part of project life cycle. So project life cycle means how a project starts and how does it end. So project life cycle, these explanations like project initiation is same which you do as part of project process group. So in a project initiation, project charter is developed, feasibility study is conducted, you list different type of solutions, and out of those solutions you recommend one solution, you approve one solution. So project managers are appointed at this phase as well. Then comes the project planning phase, where you plan the resources, the finances, the quality, risk, project acceptance plans, communication plans, and procurement plans. So you plan everything here in this stage. Then in execution phase, you basically do whatever you have planned. So you here work your plan, and then last stage, of course, is project closure phase. This pictorial description again describes you these phases of process groups of project life cycle. This is for your further explanation. You do have a look on this diagram at your own place. This basically graph shows you again these same thing which we talked earlier in case of process groups. So here defining or initiating a project comes in the beginning, then comes the planning phase, then execution phase towards the middle of the project timeline is at its peak, and towards the closure or end of the project is you see the closure phase. Now here there are different characteristics of project life cycle which are defined here. So first one is cost and staffing levels. So cost and staffing levels are low in the beginning of the project. So this chart basically tells you that in the beginning, cost and staffing levels are low. Then they are highest during the execution phase, and then again they reduce towards the end of the project. So this first chart basically explains about the cost and staffing levels of a project. Then stakeholder influences risk and uncertainty. So this chart, if you just have a look at this chart, this shows project timeline and degree from low to high. So it says that stakeholder influence, risk and uncertainty is more in the beginning of the project. So here, this is, if you follow my cursor, in the beginning of the project, this is highest, and towards its end, this is lowest. So stakeholder influence, risk and uncertainty level is lowest towards the end of the project. Similarly, cost of change. So if you have to introduce certain changes to the project, then the cost of change is minimum in the beginning of the project as compared to its end. Then few more parameters which we see in terms of project life cycle. This yellow curve, opportunity to add value. So in case you want to add any value or any value addition to certain project. So for any value addition to your project, you have got maximum opportunity in the beginning of the project and least towards its end. And this cost to changes, as explained in earlier graphs, so same curve is shown here, that cost to changes is minimum in the beginning as compared to the towards its end. If you just look at these ranges, constructive opportunity, this written in green, the point up to where these two curves cross each other, before that is called constructive opportunity phase, means whatever you do will cost you less and you have got certain opportunity to add value. But after this point where they do cross each other, this is called destructive intervention. So any intervention to the project at this phase 4 towards its finish will be destructive intervention, means will be most expensive with the least opportunity to add to the project. Now this is simple flow chart giving you a project management plan. So starting from the identification of the problem, then your planning phase of the project, then execution phase, then monitoring and control. So same things which we just talked, they are more easily elaborated here in this flow chart. But these flow charts and curves are much more important for you in terms of your examination, basically. So I won't be more interested in more written things as compared to that. These flow charts and curves are more important. So construction project life cycle, very simple, same thing is explained here. You have a look on this at your own place. Very, very self-explanatory. So if you still have any questions, you may ask me next time during the lecture. Again, this is very self-explanatory, stages of construction, different stages of construction project. Instead of this, I'll go to the next slide. These are very self-explanatory charts, flow charts, so you need to look at them at your own place. Now, for successful project management, basically these are a few things which you have to watch. For successful project management, the project need to be within time. This means even if you complete a project going much beyond the given deadline, that will still be called a project and that will still be called a completion to the project, but that won't be successful completion of the project. So for a project to be successful, you have to complete it within the given time. And similarly, you have to complete it within the given cost. So if you go much beyond that cost and still deliver or complete a project, that project won't be called a successful project. For a project to be successful, you have to complete it within the given cost. And then at the desired performance and technology level. So whatever the performance level or technology level is asked by the client, you have to deliver the project as per his satisfaction. You have to utilize your resources more effectively and efficiently for a successful project delivery, and then it must be accepted, satisfactorily accepted by the customer or the client. Only then the project will be called the successful project. Now, these are a few things which are called constraints of the project: scope, time, and budget. So this is also called the iron triangle of project management. So if you complete the project within the budget, within the given schedule, as per the given scope and quality standards, then it will be called the successful project. Otherwise, these are called the constraints of the project, because you have got a certain limit of budget available to you and certain time available to you to finish the project as per the given quality standards. So this is just an explanation to these things. So last thing here. Project resources. These four M's are very important on any project, which includes manpower, material, machinery, and money. But you must remember that these four M's or this resource is available in certain limit. You have not got plenty of that, but you have got certain limit to the availability and of resources, and you have to complete your project within the given resource. Only then this will be called a successful project management. So this slide basically explains the view about project management. So earlier, in past, this project management was simply considered as an additional cost to the project. That wasn't considered a good thing, but an additional cost to the project, because you definitely do hire additional staff for project management. But these days we learn that if you manage your project well, then though you do spend on that project management team and additional cost to that project management team, but but these days we have learned that instead of ending up with a mismanaged project, which may end you up at a very high cost, instead of that, if you spend little as compared to that additional cost, a little bit on the project management team, then the project will become more, the project delivery will become more effective as compared to the other scenario in which you have not managed the project well, and then you end up a more mismanaged, a more costly project. So instead of going for that more costly and messed up project, it's better to spend something on a project management team and then getting a more effective and efficient delivery of the project. All right, so this was it for today from my side. If you have got any questions, you may ask now. Let me take your attendance. बस मैं आती हूँ, आप एक मिनट रुक जाओ ना, आप ये देख रहे हो ना, ओके
दे देना.
So if you don't have any questions, then we will leave now. I just share the class attendance with you. Thank you very much. See you next time. Thank you. Love is.